Welcome to the Beyond Iconic podcast, where we dive into the vast world of art iconography through somewhat casual commentary. We're your hosts, Naja
and Crystal, two artsy friends looking beyond the icons just for the hell of it.
Welcome to the pilot, the podcast pilot.
Yes, we are here and we are
not queer.
But we accept all queers around
here. There's nothing wrong with queer. Yes, this has been a long time coming, this little project.
It really has, yes.
And it's time to celebrate with our first
celebratory
drink.
Alcoholic beverage.
Yes.
I'm not drinking beer because I'm a bitch.
I'm only drinking beer because I'm lazy and I didn't get a seltzer from the gas station.
Oh my god. Are we ready first?
Yes.
Are we ready for...
Yes.
A synchronized clink or... All right, you ready?
Yes, I'm doing it.
God. I hope that was ASMR-y.
Oh, I did put it close to the mic. Oops.
Maybe it caught it. We could do it again next episode.
God, I hate beer. For the pod.
So weird.
Tastes like liquid bread.
It does, and I hate it. But, I mean, people seem to acknowledge that it
doesn't,
you know, has a
good
bready taste because they drink it for the burps and they taste like weedy. People enjoy that.
I know. I just don't.
Can't relate.
Alrighty. So who wants to go first on talking about who we are?
I think that you deserve to go first because you are first.
Okay. I shall go first.
You are the one.
I am the one. I am.
You're the mother of this whole project. Aww. So.
Yes. All right. Well, I'm Crystal Lee. I was born and raised in Texas in a small town called Beaumont, 2 hours from Houston. That is the biggest city that anyone would recognize near my small podunk hometown. And it's musty and muggy and gross and full of crime and mosquitoes, but it's my home. I'm the youngest of four. I grew up with my siblings who all had an aptitude for art. So at a very young age, I was very inspired by what they were drawing, and we would all draw fan art. And we would watch Toonamis, and I would draw all the fan art for Toonami characters and the Powerpuff Girls, Naruto, those kinds of things. And it was really bad fan art. So bad. How can you mess up Powerpuff Girls?
Isn't that how we all start?
So bad. So, and then, like, another thing about art for me was, like, in second grade, after, like, being so inspired by my siblings, we had a homework assignment for a Holocaust book. I don't really know what book it is. I tried to look it up. I think it's Number the Stars by Lewis Lowry. Anywho, the assignment was to draw the main character of the book. So, of course, me being the little art nerd, I was like, I'm gonna friggin' destroy this assignment. I'm gonna do so good. And I colored mine. I, like, line-arted that thing. It was super anime. And I just killed it. So it was parent-teacher night, and we all had the assignments in the hallway, and I distinctly remember one of my homeroom teachers was like, her sibling probably helped her with that. And I was like, in my head, I was like, wow, thanks. Thank you for thinking my sibling had to help me for it to be this good, but also, like, I'm totally capable of making this art. So it was like double-edged sword on how I felt about that. But little did they know, I'd be a little art champ and go down that path into my adulthood. And so when I was choosing my major, there was a lot of kidding myself. As an Asian American, I felt pressured, not by my dad, but by society, to pick a stable job like nursing or engineering or like other typical Asian degrees and career paths, and eventually I went with my gut and I chose graphic design because I genuinely felt interested in it and did not question if I switch majors or if I couldn't handle it. I knew that it was something I could do and it would be stable. And I'm lucky enough to have a family who didn't look down on my dreams and aspirations. I studied at Lamar, which is located in Beaumont, my hometown, because it just made sense. We weren't a rich family, and I didn't want to burden my family with crippling debt trying to go to college out of state. And Lamar had a pretty great program, in my opinion. It turned out really well. I love my professors, and I put a lot of effort into learning everything I could, especially out of respect for my dad, who helped finance my college career. And because of how terrified I was of failing, I was like, I gotta do this because I chose this path, which wasn't as stable as it could be. So I earned my BFA in graphic design, and after living my whole life in one spot, I moved to Washington with my husband, who is in the military, to start my career. The choice was easy for me. I didn't have a career yet because I was just out of college, and Washington would be my fresh start. Because Simon was in the military, we thankfully did not have to worry about like housing or groceries too hard. We just could be there and I could freely job hunt without worrying about finances, so we were super lucky. I applied everywhere. I hated not working and feeling useless. I applied to Target and I got an interview and they rejected me, and it was the saddest. It was the saddest time of my life. I was crying in the hotel room, and I was devastated that I couldn't even get a job at Target. It was so sad. And by the grace of God, I found my current employer, Veterans Lending Group, on Indeed. Highly suggest using Indeed to find your job, by the way, not sponsored. Veterans Lending Group specialized in educating military families and their VA home loan benefit and financing military family mortgage needs. So I was like, cool, eventually I'm gonna need a house. And the description was like, you like tacos, apply. And I was like, I like tacos, I guess I gotta apply. So I went for it. And imagine me, a little military spouse moving to a new area, finding a company who caters to military families. Just like me, also hiring a marketing assistant. I was like, dang, this is too good to be true. Now, I'm not a marketing major, but I've been watching videos about how graphic designers get into their jobs. So I knew that if I could do like a graphic design internship or a marketing job, I could possibly get my graphic designer position in place for myself through those routes. So this was right up my alley. I knew if I picked this company, at the very least, I'd understand a benefit my family could use, and at best, I'd find like-minded people who I'd get to be friends with in a state where I had no one but my husband. So I interviewed, and the rest is history. I still work with them. I currently got promoted to graphic designer, and I really love my work family. The culture is just super
happy. You come yes, so far.
We love it. We love good work culture. I know. And yeah, that's about where I am. I love what I do, and I'm still growing inside and outside of
Absolutely.
My career.
Always growing. I think it's so cool that even though you didn't come from like a military family, you're like in one now, you know?
Yeah, right?
And bouncing off of that into my biography.
Heck yeah. Smooth transition.
Exactly. I am a military brat and I wear it with pride. I say brat, but I really mean rat because my art alias is the Black Rat. My mom hates that name for obvious reasons. but you know, she can't do anything about it. I just really love rats. She used to tell me that when I was little and like my dad would watch me, he would like fall asleep and I would like crawl into the trash can and try to like eat stuff. So
no!
I thought it was pretty fitting, like a little rat, you know? So
that's cute.
I have a very big appreciation for cats, or not cats. I do have appreciation for cats, but I have an appreciation for for rats specifically. And other dumpster dwellers, just, you know, raccoons, I love them so much that I circled my whole brand around these creatures. Like, it's honestly ridiculous.
They're lovable, and they need more love.
They are. Going back to my origins, here's my origin story.
Yes.
I was born in Anchorage, Alaska, and I was raised in parts of Maryland, Louisiana, and I've been currently in Texas for like over a decade, which is insane to me because when we moved from Maryland to Texas, like I was so devastated. Like I was like, I love where I am right now. Why do we have to go to Texas? Not even knowing like what life was like in Texas or is like in Texas. I just knew that I didn't want to leave where I was. But now,
I mean, oh, it's kind of a downgrade.
I can agree, because like you could say that the prices are better, but it's the same because of everything else. True. So it's really whatever. But 10 years, almost over 10 years, actually, I've been here, and I've been loving it. Honestly, I like the I like the weather. I remember liking the snow in Maryland.
What?
But only because, you know, I was a kid and I didn't have to deal with the snow. I just got to play in it. So, you know, if I was my age there, I would be tasked with shoveling the ice and the snow and everything. Fun. So that wouldn't be very fun. So that's one thing I love about Texas, is that I don't have to do that shit.
Yeah, it's not fun cleaning the ice off the windshields in the morning.
No, it really isn't. And having to reheat your car like 30 minutes before you leave, it takes so much work. But yeah, my extended family is from Louisiana, which is where I call home, even though I've been in Texas for like so long.
Right.
I visit my family all the time, and I don't know when I decided to adopt Louisiana as my home. It just kind of feels like that, because I've experienced that little town in Louisiana. It's called Opelousas. It sounds really funny.
I love it.
Opelousas, Louisiana.
Makes me think of the word opal.
Yes, but it is nowhere near an opal. They really need to like help that town out. Seriously. it's awful, but it's home. I've gone to Opelousas like multiple times in my lifetime, so I kind of consider it home because, you know, I've been there every stage of my life. I always return to Louisiana.
It's your home base.
Exactly. So I think I was around like 7 or 8 when I started watching like cartoons all the time, going into how I started having an interest in art in general. Yeah, I was like the same. I was basically the same. I think we all artists kind of have the same origin story. You know, we start with watching a bunch of cartoons, right, and anime, and
yeah,
we just go from there. It's just the natural progression of things.
We just couldn't stop. We couldn't stop loving it.
We just couldn't, literally all the time. I just said to myself, you know, F it. I'm just gonna start drawing these characters. And I had a bunch of coloring books too, so I kind of trained myself to color in the lines and, you know, I kind of figured out how to shade, you know, because I just had so many coloring books. I would just mess around with how to use my tools, which were Crayola crayons, nothing less, or I would be very upset.
Name brand.
Don't give me that.
Don't
rose
give
art.
Me that. Yes. Yes. Not the rose. Not anything but rose art.
Yes. Or crazy art. That was like worse than rose art.
Oh my god, you are touching parts of my brain that are dusty.
All wax and no pigment. Oh my gosh. And even like on my homework, I would draw, and not just like draw random characters and stuff. Like I would actually like fill in the little holes in all the letters and like change the font and how it looks, not even knowing what the hell a font was in middle school. You know, it's like I'm just coloring these holes in these letters because they're open and I want them to be closed.
Yes.
For aesthetic. But yeah, it's just something I've always defaulted to. When I'm in a dissociative state, like I just would draw, and that's all I could think about was art all the time. To the point where like in high school, I started creating characters and stories, even though I wasn't very refined at it, it's, you know, I still had an interest in all of that. So I channeled all of my feelings because I was really feeling a lot. I think we all were in high school, God, going through a lot of feelings.
Yeah.
Yes.
For sure.
But growing up and graduating high school, I kind of had to start thinking seriously about where I was going to take art and my career, because, like, you know, I'm not saying that artists can't make it.
Yeah.
I'm saying that it's very difficult these days, especially, to make it right out of school, like, as an artist. So, of course, like you said, you have to pick something that's, like, practical and can contribute to society so mm-hmm. that you can have money and take care of yourself. It's hard to get into the landscape of fine art when you aren't established already.
Yeah.
So, I decided to go into design as well. And I also went to Lamar University with my dear friend Crystal. And it was the best experience. It could have been better for
reasons
that I won't say. But
yes.
But it was really fun. And we got to room together at some point too, which was just an amazing experience because we were both kind of hyper focused on our work, yeah, and just honing in our craft. It was very quiet all the time. Very much appreciated that. Yeah. Growing up in a military family, it kind of hones in, like, security and stability. So, you know, I had to make that decision. So, and now I love design. I went into the design not really knowing much about it, but the more I learned, the more I was like, wow, this actually kind of rocks.
Yes. Yes.
It's super fun. And then you realize how much it's used in society and you're like, wow, I'll never be out of a job, hopefully.
And then it, like, ruins your life because you notice things and you're like, that thing's so unbalanced. I want to change that font.
One could say ruin, or one could say
it's a fun little,
I don't know, like, you're just enlightened.
It's like I Spy.
You just see the world differently.
Yeah, it's like I Spy. Yeah. You're like, oh, they put an extra space there.
Yes. Okay. Oh my gosh, when I was driving to Bryce's brother's house for Thanksgiving, their neighborhood, like, all of the big stone signs that you see, like, the entrance of the neighbor of, like, whatever neighborhood it is, all of those signs were in Comic Sans.
Someone
please explain to me. Even the road signs were in Comic Sans. I was like, I've never seen this in my life. Like, I've seen serifed fonts, like Times New Roman. Like, those also look weird, but it's weirder when it's Comic Sans because it's like,
well, I'll let you know, today I went to drop my cat off because I'm about to head down to Texas next week, and all of their signs had papyrus. I almost said papyrus. It's papyrus. All of it had papyrus, and I was like, it's don't say anything, don't think anything. It's a place where they house pets for people who have to be away for a while. Yes. Just don't judge it, Crystal. Don't judge it.
Oh my gosh. What was I saying? We went on a tangent.
We did.
We went on a font tangent. But honing that back in, right now I'm working professionally as a graphic designer, as well as Crystal, and we are living our best lives right now with all of that. I currently work at a digital driving range, which is kind of like a Topgolf, but it's called Five Under. They have Topgolf bays, and they also have a restaurant and a retail center. So, you know, there's like a ton of marketing collateral that has to go out constantly for literally every department. And same with you. I have a person that helps me with all of that load. So at one point I didn't, which was awful. And I really tried to be like the jack of all trades and do everything myself. But, you know, I had a breakdown at work one day and my boss, bless her heart. But yeah, she helped me through all that and then finally helped me get a partner, you know, a coworker that will take not most of the load, but like some of the stuff that
the time
is
consuming.
Like, you know, needs to be done constantly. Yeah. And now it seems like they're overworking her a little bit because she's just like, she has so much to do, and it's way harder to do it in person. And I just feel blessed that I have the opportunity to work from home, mm-hmm. which I do. And I used to be there in person, but you know, I'm just thankful that I got the opportunity to work from home because it's way easier. And that's just, you know, it works better for me personally.
Right.
But yeah, going back to art in general, it is something that I've always loved and constantly thought about. Not just visual art, but like music. I don't make music yet.
Yet. Skillshare?
But I think all art mediums are just a way for us to express our emotions and our own human experience. We all kind of translate that through all types of art. So, and I just have a huge appreciation for that. So, yeah, that's enough about me.
We need to flip a coin.
Oh, yes. Do we have a coin? Hold on. I have a coin on deck. Listen to the soft rumblings of me opening my purse and unzipping my wallet. All right. I have a coin.
Okay.
It is a quarter. What do you pick, heads or tails?
I would like tails.
Okay. Oh my god. Absolute chaos.
Jesus.
Oh my god, it's heads.
Yes!
Crap. Now I gotta dig into my psyche.
Yes.
Okay, how we met. Remember us meeting for the first time in Professor Gachot's design class. I think it was design one.
It was.
It was, okay. And I cannot remember for the life of me what we were talking about or what like lesson we were learning that day. But I do remember that we were sitting at the same table and we just kind of were making comments about whatever it was we were doing. And then we would just kind of bounce off each other's comments, I think. Like, we just sparked up a conversation somehow. And I just knew that this girl was like everything. Her banter, like, I will never be bored. I thought you were very pretty too. I kept looking at you. I was like, God, this girl.
You're so nice.
She's a whole snack.
She's a snack. Oh, is it my turn?
Yes. What do you? I feel like you have more like specific memories from our meeting.
No. So the only thing that deviates for me is in my brain, I went further with my like beyond our initial meeting and into our friendship. So the first time I saw you, it was very similar. I was like, damn, she looked like a whole Egyptian queen. Cause you had
I think I had the box braids.
You had the box braids and you had these little gold cuffs on your braids. And yes. I thought, oh my god, she looks so fucking cool. Like, those look so rad. And then I remember you introducing yourself and you were like, my name's Naja. And I was like, damn, she got a unique name too. Who is she? I must know. I don't remember. I'm bad at memorizing things.
Me too.
But what does your name mean? It means something.
It means something. And I forget what language, but it means it's a genus of cobra, so it's like a type of cobra.
Oh, she a cobra.
But I ain't no snake.
I ain't no snake. I remember Naja beyond like her being pretty and cool and everything I want to be friends with. She was a hard worker in class. She was a top dog. I envied her art and I was just like, fuck, I need to get on her level. I need to be I need to surround myself with people like her because she is amazing.
Oh my god.
And
I'm so
I slithered my way into her life.
Yes.
I slithered my way into her life. And what really kicked it off for us was us studying abroad.
Yeah, absolutely.
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 So what had happened was we had these people come to our class a week before Hurricane Harvey had come, and they were like, hey guys, if you want to come to our study abroad program in Florence, Italy, I know, top dog art school, art area, where like literally everything you're learning about in art history is there.
Yes.
In Florence.
Absolute elite.
You might
want to
come. We were like, dang, I want to go. But it just seemed so expensive to me at the time when they were telling us. And I was like, I want to go, but it's so expensive and I don't know if I actually will. But then Hurricane Harvey hit and we were on an island because Beaumont is a port and has like dams around it. So Harvey came and rained so much that the bridges on both sides, each exit was closed, and we were a island.
Very wild.
So that happened. My family's laundromat was out of business. It was wild. We were pouring water bottles in the back of our toilets just to flush. It was water bottle baths and showers. It was just, it was a hot mess. But Sarissa, our amazing international study abroad school, they reached out and they were like, hey, if you were affected by Hurricane Harvey and you can get down to Italy, Florence, Italy, like early October, we will offer you a full ride, housing, all that jazz. If you can come up here, you just need to pay for the ticket and the supplies that you need for class, and you can come. And I was like, yes. So I asked my dad and he said yes. He was like, you sure this isn't a scam? And I was like, I'm pretty sure it's not a scam.
Cause it was like through the school.
I'm willing to risk it.
So like,
yeah, they wouldn't scam us.
No.
Through the school.
Cause then I would sue.
And of course I had to tell Naja, cause girl crush, and also she was my friend, one of my best friends at Lamar by far. So I had to let her in the loop, and she said yes too.
Yes. I remember that I was like really trying to like convince myself that I was affected by the storm. Like I had to figure out like how I was affected.
Yes.
So I would qualify. And I remember going with something like, I was stranded and I couldn't see my family and
that's enough for me.
Something really like, something that was like, you know, it's just crazy that in contrast with you having to deal with like all of the repercussions of the storm. I definitely had imposter syndrome there. Like it was worse then.
Yeah, but
it's bad now. It's worse then.
I really wanted you there and I wanted you to make those excuses so you could come too.
Yes, it was worth it. And you know, they had like, I think they had 3 slots, so we just couldn't pass it up.
Yes.
Yeah.
And we did that thing. And me and Naja, there was another girl, another friend of ours named Jamie. And she was more of a social butterfly and she was more adventurous by far than me and Naja were.
Yes.
So
absolutely. Cause she's a church girl.
She's a church girl who goes to church. And is actually social to do her Bible studies, and that's how she made friends, and we didn't have that, so we had each other.
That's what my mom wanted for me. That's why she would bring me to church all the time. Mm-hmm. She'd be like, and try to like get me to the youth groups, because she knew that was like a way, because that's how she socialized when she was a kid. Mm-hmm. Too, but
right,
I was just too socially anxious.
Yes. Yeah, my dad
did not want to talk to anybody.
My dad had me in church things too earlier on in my life, and then he was like, you look stressed, you don't look like you're enjoying yourself, I'm gonna take you out of there because it's not doing you any good. And I was like, thank you, please.
Dad, props to dad for listening and watching and observing your responses to all that and actually doing something about it.
Right. But yeah, ever since then, we just never pulled apart, and I love her.
We love each other. We're best of friends, and till the end, most likely.
Till the end, most likely. Please, no, don't knock on wood. We're never gonna leave each other. You're stuck with me.
Absolutely. I'm like, not if I have anything to do about it.
That's right. I'm gonna fucking bite your ankles like a little rat, and you're a rat. And we're yes. just gonna hold each other's ankles.
The rat jaw grip on her ankle.
Yes. So that was how we met. And how did we come up with this concept and the creation of this podcast, Beyond Iconic Podcast? So I've been feeling pretty lost on what to do with my career beyond like what I do in my workplace. Visualizing what I want to do and grow as a graphic designer is really hard for me because on one hand, I have a job. I feel super comfortable and safe in all the things I do there. But I've noticed myself getting a little complacent in not progressing my skills because like, oh, I have a job. I don't need to learn really because I'm doing fine in my job. But at the same time, there's so much that I want to do that I'm interested in. And I just end up getting overwhelmed by all the things that I want to do. And then I end up doing nothing. So when this idea came to me to do a podcast going into like iconography and symbolism, I knew it had to be Naja. I knew she had to be a part of it for so many reasons. She was interested in symbolism as much as me. And we could bounce ideas off of each other so freely. And I knew that because we were roommates. We are best friends and we talk about multitudes of things. We just,
yes.
It just flows so easy for us. So I was like, there's no way it's not going to be her.
Oh, and I'm so honored. I'm so absolutely so honored to be the choice for this project because she could have picked anybody, but deep down I knew it was going to be me.
It was never anybody else but me.
It was always you.
And I love an excuse to talk to you.
Yes, we need an excuse to just be in our lives constantly.
Yes.
No excuses. Now you can't just ghost me. And it's exactly. Kind of like a contract. Like we're doing this project together and you say you're all in, you better hold that up or you're dead to me.
You're off the project. Actually, I need to back. I can't do it without you.
No, there's no way I would pass this up because it's just, I thought it was such a cool idea. And I'm all for that, you know, challenging yourself as well, even though I tend to not do that because yeah. I also get overwhelmed with everything that I want to do. So I just choose to do only the things that don't require a lot of work from me, which is bad. It's bad if you want to grow as a person and an artist yeah. for sure. So yeah. I thought that this would also do the same for me. So, yeah, I couldn't pass it up.
Couldn't pass. So yeah, and like we've just started it, this project, and I'm already like so excited to dive into art. I'm so excited to dive into symbolism, and I feel like I've found my path outside of my career that I want to follow and enrich my creative spirit because it's really already doing that for me. So I'm just so excited for when we can look back at this and be proud that we actually made something. And be like, absolutely. Damn, we really did that.
Yes. Legacy.
Legacy. Oh, God. It's time for the meat.
Time for the meat. Are you guys ready to eat it up? Because it's about to get really rambly.
It's icon time, beaches. So the theme for this one is what got us into iconography. And for me, I honestly had the hardest time figuring out what I wanted to do for this pilot episode because Naja knows I couldn't for the life of me name any of the art pieces that I studied in art history that first year that really sparked it for me. And I remember having a fascination about Egyptian art and cryptography, but my memory was just like, no, they all look the same. I don't remember any
That's not politically correct.
I know. So I'm sorry, Dr. Fisher. I really was intrigued by what you were saying, but they just look so similar to me, and I don't, and all the names of the people I can't even pronounce. So I'm just
so
gonna give
harder.
It to I know. And then I was like, I want to do the symbol Eye of Horus, but then I learned that there's also an Eye of Ra, and that everybody is using the Eye of Ra, not the Eye of Horus. It was just too convoluted at that point, and I was just like, I'm gonna find something else. So eventually I decided on something very near and dear to my heart, my art heart. The La Primavera, or Spring, by Sandro Botticelli. You may know Botticelli for his Birth of Venus painting. It's the one with the naked lady on the shell. And if you know it, you know it, because that thing is super freaking famous. And if you don't know it, you probably don't like art. Anyways, there is so much to love about La Primavera. It is absolutely stuffed to the brim with details. If you've never seen it, it lives at the Uffizi Gallery in Florence, Italy, alongside the Birth of Venus and many other amazing painting and artworks. Me and Naja had the privilege to actually go see it in person while we were studying abroad, and it is magnificent to see in person. Its scale is just like, it was just gorgeous. And he's so detailed that there's like more than 100 species of vegetation that could be identified just in La Primavera. Anyways, it was painted near the beginning of the 15th century during the Renaissance and is speculated by art scholars to be created for the marriage of Lorenzo di Pierfrancesco de' Medici, who was the cousin of Lorenzo the Magnificent, a super rich and important patron of the arts during the Renaissance. A lot of the symbolism of this piece is devoted to mythological ties such as Cupid, Venus, symbols of love, the three graces, symbols of feminine virtue, chastity. The graces are dancing with flowing fabric, with pearls symbolizing purity in their hair, whilst being aimed at by Cupid, and Hermes is on the side with his winged shoes, keeping the clouds away. Absolutely filled to the brim with symbolism. But what I do not like about this painting, or particularly love about this painting, is that trigger warning for anybody who is sensitive to sexual abuse. Please skip ahead to Naja's part if this is too much for you. There is, on the right side, Zephyrus, the west wind, kidnapping Chloris, a nymph who was then raped and then transformed into Flora, the goddess of flowers, vegetation, and fertility. So she was raped, and then he marries her, and she turns into Flora, the goddess. This story is based in Greek mythology and is accredited, according to my Googlings, Ovid's Fasti of May 3rd. These things don't matter to me. I just needed to figure out where it came from, because I was just like, who thought of this? Who in the world? So yeah. A fasti is a calendar of feasts and gods, and it's told in Latin. So I just wanted to read a short little excerpt from the translation for you, because I just thought it was fascinatingly like vile, and like as a modern woman to like know that it's still happening, and like this was so many years ago and it was taught in a religion and people like worship these gods is just like beyond me. So this is from Ovid's Fasti, book 5, for May 3rd, translated by A.S. Klein, 2004. All rights to him, because I definitely did not pull this, like I googled this. So this is the excerpt. He followed me. I fled. He was stronger. And Boreas had given his brother authority for rape, by daring to steal a prize from, I don't know how to say that, house. Yet, he made amends for his violence by granting me the name of bride. I've nothing to complain of in bed. I enjoy perpetual spring. The season's always bright. The trees have leaves. The ground is always green. I've a fruitful garden and the fields that were my dowry. fanned by the breeze and watered by the flowing spring, my husband stocked with flowers richly and said, "Goddess, be mistress of the flowers." So, I know, it's horrible. So basically, her consolation prize for being violated was getting to be spring forever, and she was apparently okay with that because she loved the colors and the beauty of spring, because it made her a goddess and gave her mother a goddess, a son-in-law. But what does that mean symbolically for us, looking at this as a piece of history, as something in art? What does that mean symbolically for us, for a painting that's meant to be about love and marriage? And when I look at it, I see that as like, it's telling us men of power can rape you and then gloss over it with gifts and status. Mm-hmm. And that's just one of many stories in Greek mythology, and rape and cheating are common in it. And it's just interesting. They make interesting stories, but they were at a time of religion, and I think that the symbols give the painting a darker tone for me, knowing the story behind it and the meaning. And the meaning of the painting in itself is unclear. Art scholars still don't know the exact purpose behind it. Knowing what happened on the right side, her being raped, it makes me see the rest of the symbolism in a new light. For instance, the Cupid is blindfolded and is about to shoot at the three graces, chastity, beauty, and love. And to my knowledge, once struck with his arrow, a person automatically falls in love with whoever they see first. So the choice is taken out of the equation for them. And Venus is looking like Palpatine, like her hand is pointed towards them, like as she's saying, do it, make them love.
For sure.
Just do it.
Has that energy, for sure.
It has that energy. So mythology has just fascinated me, and I'm sure we will talk more about it as the series goes. And if you like mythology, I highly recommend Lore Olympus, and there's like a new chapter coming out tonight, and that's about Hades and Persephone.
Yes. Yes, not only is this the highlight of my night, but that update is also the highlight
it's
of my
awesome.
night. So yes. We will definitely be talking more about mythology, because Greek mythology has so much like symbolism, and it's even easier when the icons are literally the things that they are being the Greeks were worshiping, and they're personified as, you know, so it makes it easy for analysis.
Yes, right?
Which is awesome. So we will definitely be talking more about that for sure.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that is awful. That whole excerpt. Oh my gosh. Okay, the part. I'm sorry. I'm a child. But the part where she was like, "And I've nothing to complain of in bed."
I know.
That's a lie.
It almost sounds sarcastic. Right?
But yeah, this is just deep stuff. It's deep stuff for sure. Alrighty. I guess that marks my entrance now.
Yes.
Yes. Thank you, Crystal, for your contribution today.
Sips. All right. Sips nervously.
Sip nervously. That was just to, lubricate the trachea.
Yes.
All right. So I also had a pretty hard time deciphering what specifically drew me to iconography and symbolism in art. A memory that's currently sticking with me is Crystal and I's class. This is another Italy flex. Sorry if you're annoyed already, but we will be talking more about our trip because it was that transformative and how it relates to art and our experience with it. So deal with it. But yeah, Crystal and I had a class. It was like an art Renaissance history class. And we visited the San Marco Convent in Florence, Italy. And here, our class was led by our art history professor. She was a wonderful lady. I'm forgetting her name, but I feel like it started with, like, an F. It was like...
I thought her name was Marco.
I don't know. Wait, is it? Was it?
Maybe?
I don't know. But I got no I'm idea. So sorry. If you ever hear this...
Honestly, I can't remember any of them.
I only remember Gloria.
I know. Okay. Oh my, I'm thinking about Gloria. Gloria's last name is Marco.
Oh, you're so right. Yeah. Gloria, she was an eccentric being, but yeah. Our art history teacher, she was leading us through this beautiful sanctuary, and we reached the refectory. We reached it. We reached the refectory, which, for those who don't know, which I didn't, I had to look it up myself, is a room used for communal meals in an educational, or in this case, a religious institution. We were in the refectory in the hostel part of that convent, and we encountered Dominice Ghirlandaio's Last Supper, circa 1486. He's mainly known for being, quote, from Britannica. I'm not Britannica. I always read it as that. It's Britannica?
Britannica.
Britannica.com. Britannica. When we were in our history class, like, I always went to that website. Like, there's so much information. Quoting from that website, he was known for his early Renaissance paintings from the Florentine school that he went to and studied at. He's noted for his detailed narrative frescoes, which include many portraits of leading citizens in contemporary dress, which I thought was interesting. And reading that, I went back to some of his paintings and noticed, you know, all of the fashion trends and stuff that he was kind of putting into his art. I thought that was really cool. The year 1486 is important because he actually made 3 Last Suppers in his lifetime, and the one I'm talking about is the youngest of them. The other two are located in the Abbey of the... I'm gonna butcher this so hard. Of the... in the Abbey of San Michel. I'm already stumbling. San Michel Arcangelo Apassignano. Sorry if I butchered that. Don't let my terrible accent deter you from visiting, because it was, yes. You know, it looks really beautiful, honestly. Crystal, I'm sure you know this one. The Convent of Ognissanti. We visited that place also. And if you look up pictures, you'll probably remember, because I definitely remember going there and seeing that other Last Supper. Oh man, I skipped a really good part in the text. I have to go back because I made a joke about Giotto's crucifix. Giotto is another Italian painter, and his crucifix is also in the Ognissanti. And he's got such skinny arms, but like his torso is so wide and it just looks so funny. I had to put that in there. I'm sorry. Because people listening, you have to look that up. I don't know if it's just me, but that is really funny and amazing. But yeah.
Ugly Renaissance babies. Yes. Add that to your list.
Yes,
and
that too.
Add the crucifix by Giotto. You gotta give yourself a giggle.
Yes, absolutely. But going back to Ghirlandaio's Last Supper, it wasn't so much a specific icon that caught my attention. It was a hodgepodge of things. During our visit there, our art history professor at the time was teaching us about the different icons in the painting and what they meant. Like the peacock in the window, which signifies the resurrection of Christ, or a cat, which I'm specifically going to talk about because cats are amazing. Cats signify treachery or deceit in biblical terms. So only those who are knowledgeable about iconography will notice the small nuances. And speaking of, it's interesting thinking about how the cat was symbolized in biblical eras in contrast to how people use cat iconography today to represent mischievousness or mystery or even grace, which I definitely see grace when I see cats walk by now.
Yes.
And
catwalks?
Yes. And all the art that I, well, most of the artists that I see, contemporary artists, they, when they depict a cat, it's almost always in like a positive light, and they're accentuating their form and the way that they move. Like it's just everything complements the cat now. The internet definitely remade what the image of a cat represents. I think with memes, especially, cats are just seen as charismatic, selective little buddies, you know, They're very selective about who they associate themselves with, and I think we think of that as like refined. Mm-hmm. And some people hate it. That's why they hate cats, because they don't like boundaries. Circling back to the Bible, it kind of makes sense historically why cats would be revered as dirty, wild, and untrustworthy, mainly because in Egypt, cats were believed to bring good fortune, much like other Eastern and Middle Eastern cultures, and were worshipped. And we all know how Christians and Catholics feel about worshipping anything other than their monotheistic God. Yeah, the pagans. Yes. We're getting to the pagans right now. Cats are highly regarded as spiritual familiars in pagan culture. In Norse culture, Norse culture, the goddess of love rode on a cat-drawn carriage, which is just the epitome of style, in my opinion. Like, that just really makes a statement when you're driven on a cat-drawn carriage.
They're small, cute ones. That's so cute.
I should have looked up a few, like, art pieces of her. Like, I only saw one, so there might be some where, like, the cats are bigger, which would be really... That would make more sense than just having like a bunch of cats.
Yes.
Just like a sea of cats.
If you listeners out there know anything about cat-drawn carriages, let us know on one of our social media pages.
Yes. It's said that the idol of the cat was demonized solely because they were associated with female cults and their goddesses that rejected Christianity. Interesting stuff. In Ghirlandaio's painting, the cat sits behind Judas as if to clearly indicate his disloyalty. This makes me think of the black cat superstition as well. In this painting, like, the cat isn't black, but we know now that in the Bible, cats are not really like seen as good things. Mm-hmm. I'm sure we all have tried to figure out why people have this superstition about the black cats.
I'm wondering.
That's why I looked it up. So... Yes, it's believed to be a bad omen, which is interesting. It was believed in Norman and Germanic culture that witches use black cats to carry out their quote-unquote evil deeds. So there commenced a mass eradication of black cats and probably darkish cats, because again, the cat in the painting wasn't a black cat, but it was still used as an icon of, you know, untrustworthiness. So it must be eradicated. That whole eradication of cats was believed to have caused the overpopulation of rats that sparked the Black Plague. So I guess that's what you get when you disrespect the cat, okay? Excruciating agony and death.
Payback is real.
That is
so
all you
real.
Get.
Wow.
Payback is real.
Wow, I love that. Yes. I love learning about cats.
Yes. Cats are, we hold them near and dear to our hearts, both of us, because Crystal is a cat mom. I was a cat mom, so we both know like what it's like to take care of those little furry boys, and I just cannot ever see them as like evil or anything at all, you know, like how they used to be depicted. I didn't have time, but I was talking to my dad about this episode, our pilot and everything, and like what I was gonna talk about. And it's interesting because he just watched this movie, I forget the name, but it's the main character is played by Benedict Cumberbatch, and it's basically this British painter who basically grew in a super huge affinity for cats, and that's like, he was known for his drawings of cats, his paintings of cats. Like, people really loved his cat content. And it's believed, well, I won't say it's believed, but I think that he also contributed in a way to the public perception of what cats are, because in that era, it looked pretty old, but not as old as like what I'm talking about. But I'm sure like in Britain, because it was like being industrialized and like, you know, cats were always on the street in alleys, like they were kind of seen as dirty. Aww. Still, maybe not for religious reasons, but because you saw them in alleys all the time and you know?
Yes.
I remember in cartoons, like, especially Tom and Jerry, where the they...
Yes.
Like, Tom would be beaten up by, like, brooms, and, like, any outside cat would be, like, tossed around. They really yes. didn't like the cats in the
always,
house. So.
They were always the antagonists, the cat.
Mm-hmm.
It's crazy.
Yeah. In the kids' movies, too, like, about dogs yes. and cats, the rivalry, it's like the dogs are always seen as, like, the good guys and the cats are the bad guys. Why? Someone please tell me why. Is it because they're selective with their love?
Even in pets.
If people don't like that.
The owner, or, like, whoever made the character for pets, I feel like maybe doesn't have a cat. Because they're not lazy. Like, my yeah. cat has crackhead energy all the time. And my sister's cat did too. And I know yes. your cat, one of them at least, had some crackhead energy.
both of them for sure. And then they made her fat too, so like
I guess
her fatness contributes to her laziness too, which is another discussion.
Yeah.
For another day.
Different discussion.
I really enjoyed learning about these today.
Yes, I did too. And I'm so excited for the next episode. The official first episode.
The official first ep.
Epi. This is the pilot.
We stumbled a lot.
If you didn't hear that. You didn't notice we're beginners in what we do, but we're just excited yes. to get started, and I have no idea how much we're going to keep in, but whatever you hear, like, don't judge us. This is our first time, okay?
I know, right? We're going to have to edit the audio, like, really good. So it doesn't sound, like, awful.
Oh, God. Thanks so much for looking beyond the icons with us. This was the pilot episode of Beyond Iconic, and we are so thankful to have made it this far. If you thought this was interesting to talk about, to discuss, tune in for more. Our first official episode will be coming out January 28th. With the theme of new beginnings. Ooh.
Ah, yes. Just in time for New Year's.
Yes. A new beginning in the new year.
Yes. Let's hope this year rocks.
I know. Hopes for success.
All right. It is now time for our shameless plug.
Yes.
If you're interested in following us on our social media, for updates and community interaction, our podcast is Beyond Iconic Podcast on Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. We'd love to see art that piques your icon interests.
My personal social medias is Crystal Lee Design on Instagram. That's all I really have. Deal with it.
Yes, and I am Raise Days, R-A-E-S dot D-A-Y-Z on Instagram and Facebook. And my art only account is Black Rat Studio if you're interested in seeing some provocative drawings.
Amazing black and white art with fabulous yes, shading.
I'm trying to branch into color soon, so I just got a commission. I just got a commission from my friend Tristan. He wants me to do a cover up of his guitar. Like, he has a guitar that someone painted and he wants to get it repainted. Yeah. And I was like, I'll do that, because he found my art account and he was like, this is you? You should have been dating Bryce for like 18 months ago.
Oh my god.
Because that's when he asked the other artist to do it.
Yeah.
And I
oh
was
my
like
god.
Oh dang, sorry.
Well, I'm but here yeah, that's, now
yes, that's going to be my next big project. So I'm probably going to film a video of that. So that might be on my YouTube.
Black Rat Studio.
Very soon.
Wait, whoa. What channel? What's the channel name? Give them the channel name.
Oh, the channel name is That One Quiet Girl. It's my name on my Instagram. So you won't be confused. Like, once I actually start posting, I'll put a link in my bio in Instagram and Facebook too, so hopefully that will help with navigating the landscape. Mm-hmm. Yes, but this was awesome. I cannot wait to do it again. And yes. We will see you guys and
next
hear you guys
time.
Next time. Peace out, guys. Have a great night/day whenever you're listening. tune back in for some amazing icons
and conversation.
Yes. All right. Peace out.